Thank you very much, and welcome back. I'm Peter Spiegel, U.S. Managing Editor of the Financial Times, here with Yannis Stournaras, the Governor of the Bank of Greece. And we were just discussing that I think the first time we met was 10 years ago when you were the Finance Minister. So
exactly.
It's been a long, long trip.
Long time.
I want to start with, frankly, what's been on the top of the news here, which has been the threat of inflation. And I want to sort of set the scene because when my office, when we first contacted your office about this panel, we were in a very different situation. It looked like the U.S. was rolling out its vaccine very quickly. It was the Biden fiscal stimulus was hitting, and you had a lot of nervousness in the U.S. about inflation. But in Europe, the vaccines weren't going as smoothly. There was not as quick fiscal stimulus, and you saw the ECB increase some of its bond buying because of concerns that things were going the opposite direction. Now here we are, 2 months later, and suddenly vaccines are rolling out in Europe, and there is fiscal stimulus hopefully coming from Brussels in these national plans that are coming, and suddenly Europe is a little bit worried about inflation as well. Tell me a little bit how concerned you are about the threat of inflation. The markets are clearly concerned both in Europe and the US. How concerned are you?
Okay, this is a good question. You know, in economics, you can never say I'm 100% sure about that. So I can tell you what the situation in Europe is first. In Europe, we expect inflation to be about 1.5% this year. But mostly on there are temporary factors like VAT in Germany, oil price. Next year we expect this to fall to 1.2%, then the year after to go to 1.4%, and the models go further away. In 2026 we expect to be 1.8%.
So still below 2%.
Still below 2%.
Yeah.
So according to available evidence, and according to our neo-Keynesian models, I insist on that, we are not yet close to our target.
Okay.
Perhaps in the United States the situation is different, it's in a different phase of the business cycle, but in Europe the fear of inflation is not yet here.
Okay. Now, obviously in March, there was an increase in bond buying at the ECB because some of the signs that actually the business cycle was declining again, double-dip recession. Given that the economics and the vaccine rollout and other things are looking better now, do you anticipate a change in policy going ahead? Would you advocate a change in policy in terms of the
no,
QE?
Up until March 2022, we continue with our PPP program with TLTRO. So we don't see any evidence that we should change our policy yet.
Okay.
So smooth sailing for the moment.
Let me take a step back, because we've seen a debate and actually an interview in the Financial Times with your colleague Ali Wren, where he was advocating an overshoot, like the Fed has discussed, that the 2% was fine in peacetime, but we're a little bit in wartime now, and that like the Fed, since we've been below 2% for so long, perhaps we should consider going above 2% for a while to make sure the economy picks up. What are your thoughts about that issue?
Very close to Ollie's views. I mean, in fact, in Europe, many people are thinking that the 2% is a ceiling and not a target. This is a problem. This has a disinflationary bias in our monetary policy. As you know now, we have a strategy review. It's very likely we're discussing this. We're discussing the issue of inflation, of making 2% a target rather than a ceiling. Of course, we have not decided it yet. But I think we are very, very close. Perhaps by the autumn we'll know what is the new target, if there is any, if there is agreement. I hope there will be agreement, because I think it's correct to have a 2% target, average target. I think the Federal Reserve has done well in revising its strategy.
Well, and let me, if you wouldn't mind, just sort of articulating why you think there needs to be a change in that. I mean, is it the issue that Wren has raised, which is...
Because the definition of price stability is 2%, is not below 2%. That's what we know. And on top of this, the markets now think that in the Eurozone, the ECB's target is not 2%, it's 1.6 to 1.8. Mm. This means a disinflationary bias for our policy. That means the monetary policy is not as expansionary, or was not, because now it is, was not as expansionary as we thought it was going to be. And we never hit our inflation target for many, many years now.
Yeah. And is that a factor? I mean, the fact that we have so underperformed, for lack of a better word, on inflation, do you think that that it justifies a little overperformance and overshooting?
Or? Yes. When we say that inflation is 2% on average, it means that undershooting should imply overshooting. Now, by how much, by how long, there are technical issues that we have to settle later.
Let me go back to my original question, because, again, I flew here from New York. The debate very much is on overheating of the economy. Again, the U.S. has been much more aggressive than Europe on fiscal stimulus. And again, better now in Europe on vaccines, but certainly the U.S. was faster out of the chute. Are those the two main reasons why the Eurozone economy is underperforming the U.S.? Is it vaccines? Is it stimulus? Or are there still other structural issues that you see in the Eurozone that, that is causing it to underperform still?
Vaccine is one, definitely is one thing. A more expansionary fiscal policy, despite the fact that in Europe there are automatic stabilizers, because in Europe we have a welfare state that you don't have it in the United States, also helps. But taking everything into account, my view is that, if you take into account both the national fiscal policies plus the NGEU in Europe, I think that in the United States still fiscal policy is more expansionary. Yeah. I mean, you had the Trump package, you had now the Biden package. The Federal Reserve followed a more expansionary policy before, not now. Now we're keeping up with the Fed. So overall, it's both a question of policies, but also it's a question of, I would say, more flexible economy. The United States is one federal state.
Yeah, yeah.
Some of us were aspiring to make Europe the same, the United States of Europe. We're far away from that, of course. But that also plays a role. There's a deeper capital market in the United States. We want now to create a capital market union in Europe. We want to increase the international role of the euro. So all these things will make Europe more resilient, more flexible, perhaps closer to the United States.
You mentioned that both there was the Trump fiscal stimulus and the Biden fiscal stimulus, and then there's another Biden infrastructure bill. Does that mean you advocate more fiscal movement in the Eurozone? Do you think that the governments and the European authorities should actually?
No, I think now we are okay.
Okay.
We underperformed before, but now I think what we have now, we have a relaxation of the Stability and Growth Pact. We have the NGEU, 750 billion. Yep. Greece is one of the largest recipients in terms of GDP.
Yep.
But it was also ready to do it. One of the most well-prepared, I think, member states.
For change.
So it deserves for a change, as you said, yes. So now I think both fiscal and monetary policy are on the right mix.
Okay.
And it's something which we wish that this kind of flexibility will continue. Of course, we know that we have to go back to more normal policies, but we hope that this will occur at the same time that GDP growth occurs as well. Not before.
I want to ask you about return to normality, but one last question on inflation. We've heard the Fed, Lael Brainard, others say that they think inflation, if it comes, will be transitory, that it's a year-on-year issue. The economy's growing well now, and if you look at what happened in March and April of last year, obviously there was the lockdown. Is that your view? If you look at the global economy, and again, obviously you're not worried about it in Europe necessarily, but in terms of your view about the market fears right now, should they be more calm because this is just a transitory issue? Is that how you view it?
Well, market expectations, as they are derived from swaps, they show some increase in expectations. There's no question about that. But I think what happens now, there are two conflicting forces regarding inflation. One is the forces that come out of the pandemic, constraints in supply, pent-up demand due to savings.
Yeah.
So these forces tend to increase inflation.
Yeah.
But also you have all those old forces, what in the United States some economists started with Alvin Hansen, then with Summers called secular stagnation, or other forces that keep inflation down, keep the Phillips curve subdued, which is modern technology, more competition from China, aging of the population. So these forces are here.
That's a very good point.
So which ones will win? We don't know. In Europe, our models, again, I'm in the models because we have models which make the predictions, show that we are not yet to worry about inflation, or not to worry as perhaps in the United States.
It's a good
but even
point.
In the United States, yeah. we don't know. As you know, the labor market data came out a few days ago. They're weak.
Yep.
So we have to wait, to be okay. patient. I agree with Ms. Bernard that
it's a good point because you know we've now been, gosh, more than 10 years with QE, and everyone keeps predicting inflation, and it never comes. So I suspect you're right that this is another one of these fears that may never materialize. Let me change topics because we don't have much time. I want you to talk about return to normality. And one of the things that obviously when we're in Greece we talk about is deficits and debt. And right now, during this emergency phase, the sense I get from Brussels is there was a willingness to allow stimulus to happen for obvious reasons. Are you worried at all that the budget cutters in Brussels at some point will come back to Greece and say, guys, you know, this government in particular has been cutting taxes, there's been some fiscal stimulus, some spending plans, we need to go back, we need to relook at your surpluses. How concerned are you that the Commission and others will look at Greece and bring back down the fiscal hammer?
I think there are lessons to be learned both in Greece and in Brussels and in the IMF from the Greek crisis, mm-hmm. from the present crisis as well. And the lessons is that you shouldn't follow a procyclical fiscal policy. I mean, a country which has minus 4% or minus 5% growth, you don't ask it to take austerity measures. Yeah. I think this lesson has been learned. Mm. On the other hand, the Greek political system must also learn the lessons that you don't let the fiscal situation to get out of hand. So I think we are in a much better situation now, where there's a better understanding. I don't think that in Brussels they will ask us to come back to austerity. Definitely we must come back to more normal primary surpluses, not the situation we have now, which is extraordinary. But we shouldn't worry about if at the same time GDP growth goes up. Because what is important is to keep what we call in the economic profession jargon the snowball effect, which is the difference between the growth rate and the interest rate. This should be kept positive.
Yeah.
That was what created a disaster in Greece, because if you take austerity measures, you reduce the deficit, okay, but on the other hand, the snowball effect, okay, the snowball effect is such that you lose whatever you have gained from the primary surplus.
So we have to be
absolutely. So we have to be very careful.
Yeah.
We have to create perhaps new rules for the Stability and Growth Pact, more realistic, not a whole book, simple rules that we can follow, and be realistic. Don't ask countries to do things that it's not only. I will tell you one example. In Greece now, we have a debt to GDP ratio of 200% of GDP. It's extremely easy, just a simple arithmetics, to show that 1% better snowball effect, that is difference between growth rate and interest rate, is twice as good as 1% a higher primary surplus.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
we must keep this in mind.
Now, it's interesting. I mean, I know we've had these conversations, again, off and on for 10 years. You've been advocating for this for some time.
Oh, yes.
Your sense is, though, what you're saying is you think that you've won the theological argument to a certain extent, that in Washington and Brussels, IMF, you know, you think that there's a change in thinking in most of the authorities here?
It was painful, but I think it was worth insisting on that.
Yes.
I think now this lesson has been learned.
Well, I hope you're right on this one. It's been a long fight. Let me change topics here because there's another issue that's faced a lot of central banks that's frankly on a completely different level and led in many ways by the Bank of England, which stress tests a lot of its financial system on the issue of climate change.
Yes.
Now, again, a bit of a debate. I spoke with Larry Summers not too long ago who's very much opposed to this. His concern is when it comes to macroprudential issues, there's so much on the plate right now of central banks. You know, he pointed to Archegos and said, look, you know, this is a leverage that no one knew about. There are dangers in the system right now. If we give another role to the central bank, you know, which is climate change, that is putting too much on their plate. What is your view? Do you think that central banks should play a role in assessing
risks? Let's start from climate change.
Yeah.
Climate change is extremely important. It's the mother of all failures, of the market failure. It's the tragedy of the commons. I mean, we cannot coordinate ourselves, countries, you know, better than me. And we cannot control the horizon. It's such a long-term problem. Markets, don't care about 50 years from now. There aren't such instruments. So it's a serious problem. It's a serious problem, and it's much more serious here in the Mediterranean.
Yeah.
We have, in the Bank of Greece, for more than 14 years now, we are dealing with climate change. The cost is enormous. I talked about here yesterday in this forum about the cost of doing nothing in Greece is 700 billion up to 2100, when our GDP is less than 200 billion. So that tells you the scale of the task. Now, there are some people who are saying that central banks should be market neutral, that this is an issue for the governments, not banks and central banks. It's a mistake. First of all, because we are not in a neutral situation. So there is the notion of market neutrality does not apply here. You know, Dante Alighieri had said that the best place in hell is being reserved for those who are neutral when there is a problem. I leave you with that.
But I guess the question is, Is it an issue for the financial system? Because that would imply the central bank should be a role. Because there is an argument that, as you say, this is a democratic issue, for lack of a better word, that it's the elected government that has to tackle climate change. I think it's no debate necessarily that climate change is a risk, but it's just what is the relevant authority to deal with it. And again, Summers's argument is this is not a central bank issue. This is not an issue of financial stability. It's an issue of politics and it's an issue of climate. And that's the political world is more appropriate to deal with that.
I don't agree because our primary target, which is price stability, it's been affected by climatic change. A huge volatility due to the climate change that we're going to see. Second, there are stranded assets. So banks will suffer. I mean, companies will suffer. You're going to have, if you're not careful enough, insolvencies. So this is why the central bank should affect the whole process through its monetary policy portfolio. It's not yet ready for that, but its own portfolios, its supervisory policies, and also its models should take into account in our reaction function, climatic change in our, let's say, behavior, interest rate behavior.
I wanted to follow up on this, but I'm getting a whisper in my ear that it's time to wrap it up. Governor Stournaras, always a pleasure to talk to you, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
It is a pleasure.
Back to the studio.